Leah here from leahforsci.com, and in this video, I'll take you through the reaction and mechanism for oxymercuration demercuration. Oxymercuration demercuration is an alkene addition reaction where the pi bond reacts with mercuric acetate and water to get mercury and an alcohol group attached to the carbons, followed by a reduction using sodium borohydride to kick out the mercury. This reaction is regioselective because it follows Markovnikov's rule, where the OH adds to the more substituted carbon, but unlike other Markovnikov addition reactions, there is no carbocation rearrangement because mercury acts like a carbocation babysitter, which is something we'll talk about in the mechanism. So let's take a look at the mechanism. We have a mercury ion bound to two acetate groups. OAC is simply an oxygen single bound to a carbon, which is double bound to another carbon and a CH3. Acetate is the conjugate of acetic acid and has a negative charge. Here we have two of them bound to the mercury ion. To start this reaction, we have the nucleophilic pi electrons reaching out for the electrophile or the mercury atom. Mercury cannot have three bonds, and so one of the acetate groups will be kicked out along with its lone pair of electrons to float around as acetate in solution. To show the product, we redraw the carbon skeleton, but now we have a question of, do we add mercury to the primary carbon or to the secondary carbon? This is a Markovnikov addition reaction because we have that fleeting carbocation forming, and Markovnikov's rule says you form the more stable intermediate, putting the carbocation on the more substituted carbon. In this case, the primary carbon would form a very unstable carbocation, so it's safer to add the mercury acetate there. Notice the bond between mercury and carbon is the red electrons that used to be the pi bond on the starting alkene. The secondary carbon would form the more stable carbocation, but it's a very fleeting positive charge. Mercury has a lone pair of electrons, and as soon as that carbocation forms, mercury immediately attacks before it even has a chance to undergo a carbocation rearrangement. Almost think of mercury as a carbocation babysitter, meaning that it holds on to that carbocation and doesn't let it go anywhere. So even though we have a tertiary carbon nearby, which would form the more stable carbocation, it's not happening in this reaction. Instead, we have mercury bound to two carbon atoms. The first red bond used to be the pi electrons, and the second green bond is the electrons on mercury attacking. Since the carbon is no longer positive, that positive charge transferred onto the mercury, giving us a mercurinium intermediate. Even though mercury has the positive charge, it's pulling slightly on the electrons between itself and carbon, making both carbon atoms feel that slight positive charge. The primary carbon is not as capable of holding a charge and is therefore very slightly positive. The secondary carbon would be much more capable of holding that positive charge, and therefore, even though they're both partially positive, this one is considered even more partially positive. Which means, when we have a water molecule as a nucleophile coming in for the attack in the next step, the water will be attracted to the more substituted secondary carbon and attack that carbon atom. This causes the bond between the secondary carbon and mercury to break, and the electrons collapse onto the mercury atom. The next intermediate, we now have a red bond between the primary carbon and mercury OAC. And we have a blue bond between the secondary carbon and oxygen, which is holding two hydrogen atoms. Since oxygen used one of its lone electron pairs to attack the carbon, it only has one pair remaining, giving it a formal charge of +1. I keep referring to charges on the atoms, but if you're not comfortable quickly finding the formal charges, go back to my Orgo Basics video series and learn my trick for finding the formal charge. You can find this on my website at leahforsci.com/orgobasics. We have the oxonium, or positive oxygen, attached to carbon. This is almost our product, because the final product would be an alcohol. For the next step, you can show a water molecule or acetate in solution deprotonating your oxonium. We'll show oxygen reaching for hydrogen with one of its lone electron pairs to grab that hydrogen atom. But since hydrogen can only form one bond, the electrons binding hydrogen and oxygen will collapse onto the oxygen atom, breaking the oxygen from hydrogen. What we form is the carbon skeleton with the HGOAC still attached, but now we have oxygen with just one hydrogen, its initial blue lone pair, and the new purple lone pair, restoring the neutral charge. This is the alcohol product. We also form acetic acid in solution because the acetate is now carrying that extra proton. But let's move that out of the way. The next step is where it gets tricky. Most professors will allow you to just show what happens without requiring an explanation. In fact, one of my students told me her professor called the last step magic. Now take my word for it, it's not magic, but the mechanism is slightly involved with, I think, a radical intermediate, which we're not going to show. What we will show is a simple summary of the step. For this step, we have a reduction reaction where sodium borohydride is going to replace the HGOAC on the molecule. This is called reduction because the reactive atom in this molecule is the hydride, or the H-, and when you add hydrogen to a molecule, that is considered a reduction reaction. And so here we have our final product with a green hydrogen sitting on the primary carbon, where mercury used to be, and the alcohol sitting on the secondary, more substituted carbon, in keeping with Markovnikov's rule. Be sure to join me in the next video, where I take you through a similar mechanism, except we'll use alcohol instead of water as our solvent to get a completely different product.
Are you struggling with organic chemistry? Are you looking for resources and information to guide you through the course and help you succeed? If so, then I have a deal for you, a free copy of my ebook, 10 Secrets to Acing Organic Chemistry. Use the link below or visit orgosecrets.com to grab your free copy. After downloading your free copy of my ebook, you'll begin receiving my exclusive email updates with cheat sheets, reaction guides, study tips, and so much more. You'll also be the first to know when I have a new video or live review coming up. If you enjoyed this video, please click the thumbs up and share it with your organic chemistry friends and classmates. I will be uploading many videos over the course of the semester, so if you haven't subscribed to my channel yet, do so right now to be sure that you don't miss out.